Welcome back, geology fans. The deeper into the earth we go, the hotter it gets and pressure gets greater and greater. The minerals of a rock that get buried or tectonically subducted deep enough will leave their previous comfortable conditions and begin to change to relieve stresses and achieve thermal and chemical equilibrium. As long as the rock remains mostly solid, retaining its general features, it can become a metamorphic rock. Heat and pressure alone tend to make textural and mineralogic changes, but not alter the chemistry particularly. A rock that is also subjected to injections of hot fluids can produce overall chemical changes by introducing and removing elements from the mix. Technically, changes in shape are called metamorphism, and changes in chemistry are called metasomatism. And together they produce three classes of physical and chemical changes: reorientation and lining up of rod or plate-shaped minerals, recrystallization, and creation of new minerals. The average surface temperature of the Earth is about 15 degrees Celsius, but the deeper into the Earth a rock gets subjected, the temperature steadily gets hotter. This increasing heat with depth is known as the geothermal gradient, and on average, the temperature increase is 25 degrees Celsius for every kilometer of depth, and is usually in the range of 15 to 30 degrees Celsius per kilometer. We will spend more time in the next episode investigating details and variability of the geothermal gradient and see what kind of settings could give us the extreme geothermal gradients of 5 on the low end to 60 degrees on the high end Celsius per kilometer. Temperature can also increase with an intrusion of magma, which can give us a different kind of high-temperature environment than just being taken down into the earth and subjected to the geothermal gradient. High temperature with depth is accompanied with higher pressure as well. A magma body intruding into country rock near the surface can have high temperature but relatively low pressure. Pressure is the measure of the force over an area of rock and is given in units of atmospheres, bars, pascals, or pounds per square inch, with the relative conversions shown. The international standard unit is pascals, but geologists have traditionally used bars or kilobars. It's useful for budding geologists to know the conversion that 1 bar is about 10 to the 5th pascals, or 1 kilobar about 0.1 gigapascal. Scuba divers know the pressure effect as they dive deeper and deeper below the water's surface. For every 10.6 meters depth in water, about 33 feet, you get another bar, or 14.5 pounds per square inch of pressure. This pressure is equal on all parts of a body below water, and is known as hydrostatic pressure, and is equal to the density of the water times gravitational acceleration times depth. Similarly, rocks buried below the surface get a lithostatic pressure increase of about 1 pound per square inch per foot, using the average density of overlying rock times gravity times depth. If you imagine a cube of rock below the surface, this lithostatic pressure is acting equally on all faces of that cube. For every foot you go down, each face is loaded with another pound per square inch. Together, this increase of temperature and pressure with depth will cause formerly comfortable mineral assemblages to become unstable, and reactions between mineral grains will take place to allow new mineral assemblages that are stable in this new, deep environment. It is a reasonable assumption that any point in the Earth's crust has equal pressure in all directions, but we can get unequal pressure leading to what is known as deviatoric stress. Without any deviatoric stress, a rock could be taken down to the bottom of the crust without serious deformation, even though the mineral assemblages may change. When you see rocks that are folded or otherwise deformed, you know that a rock experienced deviatoric stress. But this deformation lets us know that the rock didn't allow too much of this deviatoric stress to build up. But how reasonable is it to assume nearly equal pressure in all directions? A rock deforms when the deviatoric stress overcomes the rock strength, and tests on rocks with fluids at high pressure and temperature and slower strain rates, they can only sustain differential pressure of tens to hundreds of bars before yielding and relieving the deviatoric stress, and this usually happens at depths in the earth with thousands of bars of lithostatic pressure. The total deviatoric stress, then, can only get up to a fraction of a percent to a few percent of the total lithostatic pressure before the rock strength is overcome and deformation takes place. Pressure can do something else than just make mineral grains react, especially with deviatoric stress. Differential pressure leads to reorientation of rod or plate-shaped minerals. Minerals with one or two directions of cleavage, such as clays and micas, or pyroxenes and amphiboles, can be reoriented by pressure within a rock, and in the end give some metamorphic rocks a fabric of lined-up mineral grains. Then again, some rocks don't have any rod or plate-shaped minerals, or aren't subjected to high enough pressures for this to take place, and now we can pause and note a general dichotomous pattern in our pigeonholing of rocks. The igneous rocks can be split into intrusive and extrusive, the sedimentary rocks into clastic and chemical, and now we are meeting the metamorphic rocks, which can be split into foliated and non-foliated, with foliated rocks having a texture or fabric due to the lining up of rod or plate-shaped minerals, and non-foliated either didn't have rod or plate-shaped minerals to line up, or were never subjected to the pressure needed to foliate the rock. Let's not assume, though, that a rock that starts with one shape mineral will maintain that as it gets subjected to heat and or pressure and or chemically reactive, especially hot fluids. Recrystallization, which was barely starting in the lithifying sedimentary rocks, goes on steroids in the metamorphic rocks and takes many small mineral grains and makes larger but fewer individual mineral crystals. The original rock starts with a given overall chemistry, but higher pressure and temperature consumes some minerals to give birth to whole new minerals, with some of these new minerals appearing at specific levels of temperature and/or pressure. They can point us to how deep the rock got, and we call such minerals index minerals. To round off this overview of our metamorphic rocks, let's look at where these changes can take place. Regional metamorphism, as the name implies, takes place over larger areas, regions, often associated with mountain building or other large-scale tectonic events. This primarily happens at tectonic plate boundaries, and it is here we are most likely to encounter deviatoric stress causing folding and foliation of rod and plate-shaped minerals, which is also referred to as planar fabric, or schistosity, or metamorphic cleavage. Magma intruding into country rock can cause metamorphism with or without deviatoric stress and results in contact metamorphism. As this name implies, it tends to occur over much smaller areas than regional metamorphism and in general produces a rock called hornfels, but can be quite varied depending on the composition of the original country rock, the presence or absence of fluids, and overall temperature and pressure. Dynamic or cataclastic metamorphism is generally even more restricted in space, occurring along areas affected by shear stress and full-on fault planes, which are places where rocks have broken and moved relative to each other on either side of the break. The violence of raking one tremendous wall of rock against another can produce recrystallization and even new mineral formation and result in metamorphic rocks such as myelinite and fault melange. Some of the new minerals in the cataclastic rocks are due to fluid flow along the fractured planes, bringing and removing chemical species. This is taken to a whole new level if the fluids are significantly heated. And where such hot fluids flow, another type of metamorphism takes place called hydrothermal, hot water, deposits. Such deposits are often economically valuable as the hot water was able to move and accumulate the heavier elements in chemistry such as iron, copper, silver, gold, or platinum. The hot water often comes from magma bodies and thus is closely related to contact metamorphism with its connection to igneous processes, reminding us yet again that nature does not like to be pigeonholed. But it is easy to pigeonhole the last metamorphic environment. The impact metamorphics caused by high-velocity impact of an extraterrestrial impactor. I use that extraterrestrial impactor term so I can include anything large and fast enough coming from space, meteoroids, asteroids, comets. A shock wave propagates out from the impact site, and here we see the one other way to get this metamorphism: nuclear blasts. Both extraterrestrial impact and, to a smaller degree, nuclear blasts cause this shock wave that compresses the rocks for a fraction of a second as it passes. The compression and relaxation of minerals in shocked rocks can heat them to the point of melting or even vaporization. Some of the minerals created are index minerals that indicate pressures equal to those achieved in the mantle, and many of these impact metamorphic rocks were near the surface of the Earth when they formed. The bottom line seems to be that metamorphic rocks are made in places of dramatic impacts, mountain building, igneous events, deep subduction, and fractured rock. With temperature being the main player in all these metamorphic environments, we will take the time in our next episode to explore temperature in the Earth and how it varies with geologic environments. Here on Earth Explorations.